I find my lack of comparison videos disturbing.
So let's rectify that, shall we?
Fix it!
First off, there was only a single person that applied to get the free game key that was for Tales of Berseria. I unfortunately don't remember who that was. So. How about we run the contest one more time, in addition to adding another game to the mix? Comment on this video, join the Discord server, and say you want to be entered in the contest for receiving the key for either Tales of Berseria or Overwatch. Two winners. They will be announced in 2 weeks' time. Hello, I'm Xenko. You're watching Game Dev Made Easy, and today we're going to compare the workflows in setting up basic audio in Unity, CryEngine, and Xenko engine. I will make sure to have timestamps listed for when I do each engine listed in the description box below. Before we begin the comparison, we must first have a clean audio file to use. I like music, so how about I write a little something-something on guitar to record, edit, and export as MP3 file format to use? Yeah, I kinda like that idea, as it isn't often that I get to use my guitars in my videos. The recording software I will be using is Audacity. Yes, I have better software to use such as Reaper, or I could use Rhythmic Ultimate or Rhythmic Studio to make the music, but I'm just wanting something simple to use. Working with CryEngine can be a little confusing at first, as it doesn't allow you to drag and drop an audio file directly into the asset browser. So how do we go about adding audio into CryEngine? The answer is looking at the tools that are available. If we look in the tools menu in the toolbar, we will see the audio controls editor and is the only item that specifies anything related to audio in the engine. When we select the audio controls editor, a new menu will appear where it has audio system controls, properties, and middleware data as the main focus points. We don't want to focus on anything except for the middleware data at this point, since it has the button to import files associated with it. Click on Import Files, it will open another window to pick files, and if we look, we can see that MP3 is set as the default option. If we click on the arrows next to MP3, we will see all the supported file formats, which are MP3, OOG, and WAV. Since I created the file as MP3 format in Audacity, we will use that format. Navigate to where the file was saved or choose any MP3 file you want using this file picker window and click the Open button. Now we will see the audio file importer, and this should give you the impression that you can import more than one file at the same time. And this is absolutely true. Click to set all to import and then click the OK button. This will close the audio importer and return to the audio controls editor. We can see that the file we chose is now in the middleware data menu, but has an orange circle with an exclamation point. This means that the file is not associated with any of the audio system controls. Now we can go into the audio system controls and click on the Add button. The only option available is Library. Click on this, and if you want, you can rename it, although you don't have to for this example. Right-click on the new library we created, and we will have a few new options available when we click on Add. For the scope of this comparison, I'm not going to go into anything except for what we are going to be using. We will choose Trigger, and again, we don't have to rename it, although you can if you want to. This trigger and the library will have an orange circle with an exclamation point. This is because these items don't have an association to the middleware data. With the trigger selected, drag the MP3 file from the middleware data to the properties of the trigger. As soon as this happens, the orange circles with the exclamation points will disappear from all three of these items. In addition, the properties of the trigger will have new items made available to us. We aren't going to change anything about the properties at this point. Instead, we will just click on the save icon and exit from the audio controls editor, making sure we take note of the trigger's name and spelling. Upon saving and exiting, we will see the asset folder in the asset browser gain an audio folder. This houses everything we need for our audio being able to be used via C#, C++, or even flow graphs. Click in the assets folder and create a new folder called scripts. Navigate to be inside of the scripts folder and create a new C# script called basic music. Open it up in Visual Studio. It should be fairly obvious that we want to access a class that deals specifically with audio. Fortunately for us, this means that we only have to look at the audio class. Since it is a static class, we don't have to create a new instance of the class, and instead only have to type out audio with dot to see what is available to us. In the onGameplayStart method, type audio.enableAllSounds. This will make sure audio is enabled, and it requires a Boolean value set to either true or false. In this case, we want the value to be true. Next up, type audio.play. This will allow us to play a specific audio clip. This takes a string value as the parameter, and that string value must be the name of the trigger. Since I didn't rename the trigger, the name for me is new_trigger. Save the script and go back to the CryEngine sandbox editor. Create a new level by clicking on File and New. The Create New Level menu box will appear. In the level name box, type level/01. This will create a new folder, and the level will be called 01. The new level window box will appear. You can choose to change these settings or keep them set to default values. I will choose to keep them as the default values and click OK. Once the level has been created, it will open up the level in the perspective window. Click on Create Object and select Empty Entity. Place it anywhere you want in the level. In the Properties tab of this empty entity, select Add Component and find the basic music script we created. Click on the basic music motherfucker, that's a tongue twister. Click on the basic music script to attach it to an empty entity. Click the play button and you will hear the song play. You will notice that even if we press the exit key that the music will still be playing, and we could modify the code to fix that, but that is outside the scope of this video. My overall opinion is that while CryEngine does require more setup, the in-programming and attachment is rather quick and painless to do. With Unity, things are going to be extremely quick and easy. This isn't to say that other engines are harder or too complex, it's just to say that the Unity API has been built with simplicity in mind. I already have a blank solution loaded, so let's go ahead and set up the folders we need. Create a scripts folder and a music folder inside of the assets folder. We will use the scripts folder for our C# scripts in our music folder to store the audio file. And before you say something like, "You should put the music in the resources folder," I'm aware of this. However, this example does not need the audio file to be streamed as we are not going to be using the resources.load function. Inside of the music folder, right-click and select to import new asset. Locate the music file you want to use and click OK. This will import the music file into Unity. Inside of the scripts folder, right-click and select Create. This will open up the context menu for you to select C# script, name the script Basic Audio. Double-click on the script to open it up in Visual Studio. Once again, we know we want to control audio from the audio class. In this instance, we want to create a public audio clip and call it Audio Clip. This will be how we access the audio file to be able to drag and drop the file we want to use. Create a private audio source and call it Audio Source. This is the audio player component within Unity that we can set various data points for, such as volume, bypass effects, output devices, loops, pitch, spatial blending, and so much more. In the start method, write Audio Source is set to GameObject.AddComponentAudioSource. This will add the audio source component to whatever the script is attached to, so we don't have to worry about handling this in the editor. The next thing to do is set the audio clip we want to be played by the audio source. To do this, write audiosource.clip is set to audio clip. Finally, we want to explicitly tell the audio source that we want it to play our song. Write audiosource.play. Save the script and go back to the Unity editor. We have many ways we can do the next part. We could create an empty game object to house this or attach it to anything we want. In this case, I am going to drag and drop the script onto the camera. Attach the song to the audio source in the Unity editor. Press the play button and listen to the beautiful song being played. Isn't it great? Xenko is relatively easy to work with, but there are a few gotchas associated with it as well. The first thing you need to do is click on Start to create a new project. Name the project to be Music Tutorial. If you haven't looked at my introduction and thoughts on Xenko, I'd suggest looking at that video as it has more information on setting up Xenko Engine. Next, click on Add Asset in the Asset View. Select Media and it will give you a few choices to choose from. We have video, sound effect, spatialized sound, and music. We will go with music for this example, and when you select it, it will open the file picker window. There's a wide variety of formats to choose from with Xenko, which also includes MP3, OOG, and many more. Locate the file you want to use and click on Open. It will import the file into Asset View and display information in the property grid. This next step is very important. Make sure to put a checkmark in a spatialized option in the property grid of this file, or a crash will occur when we call the file. Now click on Add Asset and choose the Script option. Create a sync script and call it Basic Music. Click on the Visual Studio icon at the top of the editor to open Visual Studio. Before we go any further, take a look at the namespace. You should see a .game after the name of the namespace. Remove it. I have no idea why Xenko does this by default, but it causes issues with compilation. Now that the bullshit has been removed, we can continue on. Again, we know that we need to take advantage of the audio class, but if we type in audio, there's a giant list of audio classes to choose from. So let's try looking to see if there is a sound class to work from. Indeed, there is, and this looks to be exactly what we are looking for. Create a private sound instance and call it Music Instance. This is the base class for sound that can create voices or music. Create a public sound with the variable being called test sound. The sound class is specific for sound content. Over in the start method, type music instance is set to mymusic.createInstance. This creates a new instance of the sound class which will instantiate the class to be live and active based off our sound file. In the update method, we just need to write musicInstance.play. This will actually play the damn song. Save the script and go back to the Xenko editor. Click on the camera component in the main scene. Click on Add Component in the property grid of the camera entity and find the script we created. Select it to add it to the components of the camera. You have two options here. You can drag and drop the song into the slot for My Music, or you can use the picker tool to choose the song. Everything else can stay as it is currently set. Press the sideways green arrow or the play button to compile and launch the game to hear the song. The setup for getting audio to work in Xenko is rather straightforward for the most part, minus the little issue with code generation and selection for spatialized needing to be checked to allow for proper compilation. Xenko makes audio integration fairly painless and easy to incorporate into a game. My final thoughts on each engine will be a simple ranking on usability, the difficulty of implementation and how robust the features are. The rankings will be numerical, with 10 being the best and 1 being the worst. CryEngine gets a solid 8 in usability, implementation, difficulty would be a 4, and a solid 8 on robustness. Unity gets a solid 8 in usability, implementation difficulty being a solid 8, and a solid 6.5 on robustness. Xenko gets a solid 8 in usability, implementation difficulty being a 6.5, and robustness being a 7. Give me your thoughts below on what you think. Give me your thoughts below on what you think of these engines with usability, implementation difficulty, and robustness. Let me know if you think I gave fair numbers for each of these engines and whether you agree or not. I want to give a warm shout out to my Patreon supporters, Loki, Kupala, and Coburn. Thank you very much. You guys are awesome.